All right, guys, listen to me right now. Chapter 287 of the My Hero Academia story has to be one of my favorites yet. Now, mind you, we're still just working off of fan translations here, but if we're being honest with ourselves, lately the discrepancies between fan and official translations are pretty minor, with the occasional exception, so regardless, if nothing else, it's along the same lines. And if anything, reading the chapters for yourself is always advocated towards. Last we left off, Deku was in the process of having his quirk stolen by the hands of Shigaraki that were being guided by All For One. With that, the presence of Shimmerinanna would emerge to save the day. And that's exactly where we pick up with this one, as we get to see an incredible shot of Shimmerinanna who recognizes her old nemesis, All For One. And in seeing this, Deku is able to put two and two together and realize that the four of them are currently within One For All, as if it wasn't obvious enough based on his form. And from there, All For One absolutely steals the show as he begins to taunt Shimmerinanna, saying that a corpse is talking, emphasizing that she's Shigaraki's grandmother, all the while berating her with insults. With that, All For One serves to answer a question of ours from the last chapter in regards to why the past users of One For All had their collective consciousness remain within the quirk. He begins by saying that in the past, there were records of organ transplant recipients who had strangely begun to exhibit and adopt personalities quite similar to that of their donors. That despite being in this superpower-driven society, most dismissed the phenomena as mere superstition. However, All For One can certainly attest to it, as he's experienced the very same thing. That at times, he would experience the most vivid of dreams that included the possessors of the various quirks he'd taken. That afterwards, he'd somewhat feel himself conflicted by them in regards to emotions and or guilt. Which I'd imagine would certainly turn a person crazy. Having to bear that much emotional baggage is a lot, and at a certain point, maybe you just become cold and uncaring for the feelings of others as a defense mechanism. Goodness gracious, is All For One an incredible character. Continuing, he says, however, that upon relinquishing a quirk, the ghost of the previous user would never appear in his mind again. It was rather strange to him, but once he met the doctor, the foremost expert on quirks, he realized that much like organs, the consciousness of the donor may manifest within their quirks as well. But even he was surprised to see Shimmerinanna, as he assumed he was the only one able to converse with such presences. And now seeing her as well for himself, Shigaraki would finally recognize the words of Gran Torino we keep talking about, as he properly attributes the name to the face, remembering both the inspiration and hope she gave him as a child, as well as her attempt at breaking him from All For One's clutches, as he asks her why she's here. And not really paying any attention to this, All For One continues his banter, feigning remorse for subjecting his dear brother to such a fate mirroring purgatory. That furthermore, to be a holder of this power is quite the curse, which is certainly something that's been brought up quite a lot over the last few chapters, the idea of this power being cursed or a curse in of itself. Shimmerinanna then speaks to her grandson, recognizing him to be the child of her child. As in typical Shigaraki fashion, the man dismissed her, saying that regardless of her reasoning, he blames her too. Which, on one hand, I'm sort of happy about because I don't want him to repent and be a good guy or anything, but on the other, he's not asking enough questions to where I feel his stance won't later be uprooted by additional information, so it's still very questionable. With that, Shigaraki began his decay as the world of One For All began to react to his presence as the winds began to shift. All For One then congratulating his pupil, telling him that his will was now being received by the power, that its tendency to move in accordance to the will of the wielder is responding to his endless rage. And in an attempt to break free, he begins to do the same with the visage of his master, who is sickeningly pleased by this display, recognizing this to be the proper birth of the symbol of fear. However, things stop with the appearance of our next guest, the first user of One For All and the brother of All For One, who faces his brother with a single hand outstretched as he questions the manipulation of Shigaraki. all for one, barely denoting his brother's presence here by saying that it would save them a lot of time if he'd just hand the power over. Which just goes to show what kind of brother this guy was. As the younger of the two then proclaims that they won't be going as they've chosen to stay with Deku, as he now outstretches both hands, now pushing the villains back tremendously. And as this happens, All For One propels his own hand towards them, telling Shigaraki that if they combine their strength, they can take the power and finally put these sore losers to rest. Then going on to express just how useless our main character Deku happens to be. Questioning his brother's resolve, All For One says that he should quit pretending to be so strong, as he's been seeing through Shigaraki's eyes, and Deku is absolutely worthless. A sorry excuse for a successor that has no idea how to properly use such an incredible gift. Someone who couldn't protect anyone, and in the end, needed protection himself. And even beyond that, he ended up easily succumbing to rage just like his useless master All Might, which led to both their downfalls. And now is just stuck on the ground watching the real players go at it. That giving such a power to this loser was their ultimate mistake. The younger brother then refuting this by saying that his older brother couldn't possibly understand as someone who so commonly took advantage of others. That regardless of the circumstances, Deku is a person that would gladly put his life on the line for others. That the rage he harbors is for the sake of others, and without fail or limitations, he just won't stay down. And mind you, as this is all said, there is a side-by-side with Shigaraki looking like a victim to his new power. That once again makes me fear that Deku will eventually save him, but we will see. Anyways, Deku is someone possessed by the need to save others, even if it defies common sense, as Deku just charges ever forwards into the decay, as you can see it decaying his eyeballs. But now catapulted back to reality, the two split away from each other suddenly. Deku still apparently has his power, as the two are horribly beaten up. All For One then speaks to the mind of Shigaraki, telling him that his body and quirk not being stabilized was their downfall here. That his mind is secondary to his body's needs right now, as he needs to retreat and collect his energy. Deku, on the other hand, just praying that Shigaraki doesn't move anymore. From there, we cut to another scene, as Gigantomachia rampages from city to city in pursuit of his master, with the League of Villains on his back. We then see Dobby tell Skeptic to prepare himself since Shigaraki and Endeavor are together, now with a huge smile across his face, saying that they're about to liberate the hero society that they all despise. And we of course know that Dobby is far from being a loyal dog, and more so subscribes to the notion of a dog-eat-dog world, wherein maybe he's planning to kill two birds with one stone here, killing who he believes to be the biggest threat to his proceedings. Who even knows of this guy at this point? Moving from there, however, Mr. Compress then addresses Toga, bringing up the fact that she'd previously been looking out for the UA kids that she so loved despite their heroism. Toga, now taking a more serious demeanor than usual, responding with a question as to where heroes draw the line. That a hero's duty is to save people, right? So was Twice not a person to them? Will they kill her too? That these are the questions she now has for Deku and Uraraka, and that everything depends on their answers to them. And I absolutely love seeing Toga like this. It is intense and chilling, but for sure will make for some incredible reads in the future. But that is the chapter, my friends. I especially enjoyed this one on account of the goat himself, All For One, just taking over. And on the note of taking, you may have noticed that our previous chapter coverage was taken down. This now being yet another example of false copyright strikes and an infringement on our rights. The very same sort that took us out of commission for so very long before. With that, if you'd like to go plus ultra and support us against such threats, you can certainly do so by helping us out over on Patreon, wherein you will have access to several rewards, including copies of the various colored images we make ourselves here at Plot Armor that you may be familiar with in the case of our videos and or thumbnails, exclusive chapter leak discussions, and plenty, plenty more. And thank you for your help in advance, because it certainly goes a long way. And at the very least, if you're new around here, I highly suggest you subscribe to the channel, because when it comes to bringing you some of the best My Hero Academia content on the platform, Plot Armor has you covered. As always, I am Slice of Otaku. Thank you all so much for watching and have an awesome day. I love you.